The way that we're taught to think about politics in the United States and to think about the world, we're taught to think that some countries are just naturally poor countries, right? There's some countries that are naturally rich, like Western Europe and the USA, and there are some countries that are naturally poor, like, you know, Asia, Africa, Latin America. These are poor countries, these are rich countries, that's just how it is. Well, that's false. Do you know who invented gunpowder? The Chinese. Who had the first paper money? That was China. At the time that my ancestors were living in caves in Europe, in Western Europe, the people in China had a vibrant civilization. They had invented the world's first civil service examination. China was poor back in 1927 because Wall Street bankers and London bankers were keeping China poor. Now, I know there's got to be some American history buffs here in the audience, right? Now, if you're someone who's studied the history of the United States, you're quite familiar with something called the East India Company. Anyone familiar with the East India Company, right? That's the Boston Tea Party. That's back in 1776, or in the lead up to the American Revolution. The East India Company, a huge British corporation, had essentially a forced monopoly on the importation of tea. So the American colonists, they went out and they dumped that tea into the ocean, right? Very famous, the Boston Tea Party. Well, at the time that this document was written, the East India Company was hugely invested in China and had a huge monopoly in the Chinese markets. In fact, and it's interesting, one of the biggest entities on Wall Street today is what's called HSBC Bank. And that's a British bank, but what does HSBC stand for? Hong Kong Shanghai Banking Corporation. This was an entity created by the London Stock Exchange in order to dominate the Chinese economy. And one of the main things that HSBC Bank was involved in doing was importing narcotics, opium, heroin, into China as a way of, you know, subduing the people and drugging them and making them easier to dominate and conquer. And, you know, there were two wars fought by the British in order to maintain their monopoly and their control over the Chinese economy. What were they called? They were the two opium wars, right? These were wars forcing China to accept the importation of narcotics. Can you believe this, right? Forcing a country to accept the importation of narcotics. Now, the first time the US troops were sent to China, the first time that that happened, that was in 1900. And in China at that point, there was an uprising. They called it the Boxer Rebellion. That's the way American media portrayed it. You know, it was to protect missionaries, and it was, you know, Christians were being persecuted, and they didn't want to intervene, but they just had to. We've heard this song and dance. Every time there's a war, the USA is always going in to liberate and protect people. But the reality was, they were going in to protect the drug dealers from the nationalist movement. And for the Chinese people, a people with such a proud history, you have to understand how humiliating this was. In a lot of the parks in China, they actually had signs. These parks were reserved for the European businessmen. And they actually had signs in these parks that said, no dogs or Chinese allowed, right? In the parks in China, that they were not allowed in their own parks. This was deep humiliation. But China's quite a different country today, isn't it? You know, back when this document was written, back in 1927, China did not have a single steel mill. Not a single steel mill. Today, China produces half of the steel in the entire world. When this document was written, China did not have telephone service. Most of the country did not have telephones. Today, China has the largest telecommunications manufacturer in the entire world. You know, the world tourism industry is having a boom because in places like London and Paris and this city, New York, a big tourist city, there's a whole new market of tourists coming in. And you know who these people are? These are the grandchildren of those peasants that Mao was writing about. These people that were starving and hungry and illiterate, their grandchildren are now going on vacation to places like Paris and London and New York City. You can see them on the streets of this city. 700 million people have been raised out of poverty in China since 1949. 700 million people. Now, there's still a lot of poverty in China. At this point, 30 million people in China still live in poverty. 30 million. And their goal by 2020, as part of their vision of building a what they call a moderately prosperous social society, is to completely eliminate poverty in China and bring those remaining 30 million people out of poverty. Now, China's got a huge amount of problems. They've got a huge issue of corruption. People talk about human rights. They are very clear about one thing, which is that they have no desire to spread their system around the world. You don't like the Chinese political model? Don't worry, it's not coming here. It'll never come here. But the way, and this is why it's relevant to this conversation, the way that these 700 million people were lifted out of poverty, it wasn't with capitalism, it was with socialist methods. I'll give you an example. You know, in China, they declared the new laws regarding electric cars. The government went to all the auto manufacturers in China, and it said to them, you know, one out of every 10 cars that you produce must be an electric car. And they didn't just say this to the domestic car makers. They actually said this to anyone who imports cars into China. They said, if you import cars into China, you can't have cars that run on fossil fuels. One out of every 10 cars that you produce cannot run on fossil fuels. And next year, that's going to be 2 out of every 10 cars. And pretty soon, it's going to be 3 out of every 10 cars. And right now, the metals that are used in the production of the batteries in electric cars, those rare metals, are going through the roof on the stock market because people are desperate to get them. Now, the article about China's new energy vehicle regulations that was in the Wall Street Journal, the first sentence of it, they said, by sheer force of will, China has created the world's largest electric car market. Sheer force of will, right? And that's the reality. The government went to these car manufacturers, said, this is what you're going to do, and they did it. Now, this is starting to get to the essence of the difference between socialism and capitalism. In capitalism, the government works for the corporations, and that's how it is over here. They would never make such car rules here. The automakers would never stand for it. The big oil companies would never tolerate it. But in China, instead of the government being controlled by the corporations are controlled by the government, and that's a big difference.